Hello, and welcome to the Inside EVs podcast for November the 6th, 2020. This is episode number 31. Today, we'll be talking about, among other things, Tesla Cybertruck changes that we should see in about a month. Kandi EVs have been approved by the EPA for US roads, and BMW is moving to an all-electric architecture. I'm Dominic Yoni, Inside EVs editor and Inside EVs forum moderator. Joining us today, we have Tom Malogny, longtime owner and Inside EVs editor. We also have Martin Lee from the EV News Daily podcast, which is available on all your usual podcast platforms. And of course, we have Kyle Connor from the Out of Spec and One Lap YouTube channels. He also puts together the totally awesome videos for the Inside EVs YouTube channel. Go subscribe and tap that bell icon for notifications. So welcome, gentlemen of the panel and ladies and gentlemen of the audience. So let's kick things off with a little talk about Tesla news from the week. Maybe the most exciting thing we've seen this week is that we've learned that the revised Tesla pickup truck should be shown in about a month. I'm not sure if that's going to be like an actual physical truck. I kind of suspect it's going to be like a render or something, but replying to a now defunct Whole Mars Catalog Twitter account, when asked when we would see the slightly revised Cybertruck, Elon said maybe in about a month or so. And then the next day he replied to a tweet that was taking issue with the fact that they were messing with the Cybertruck design. And he said, new design is better with many minor tweaks. Even the small details matter. So we have a little time before we see exactly what they have in mind. So maybe we should make some suggestions. Tom, I believe you have a Cybertruck on order. Are there any changes that you'd like to see?
So, you know, this was obviously an early prototype that we saw up on the stage. And since then, we really haven't seen the car other than when it was on display for a little bit out in California. So I think this isn't a surprise to me that there's going to be some design changes. You know, I'd like to see more on the interior. I thought the outside looked pretty darn cool as it was. So I wouldn't want them to tweak too much on the exterior, but I'd like to see a little bit more of the interior have usability, like storage compartments, things like that, that you maybe are more important in a pickup truck than a regular personal vehicle.
The prototype, did that have like a bench seat in the front?
Yeah, kind of. So, you know, like I said, that was, you know, it really kind of smacked of something that they kind of rushed to put together to get up on the stage and do this announcement and show the car off last year. So I fully expected there to be more changes in this vehicle than what we've seen in previous Tesla vehicles, which are pretty much, you know, production baked when they first introduce it. So I don't think this is a surprise. I think we're going to see, you know, some pretty more changes on the Cybertruck than what we've seen in other Tesla vehicles, particularly on the interior, because I think that was just kind of cobbled together really quickly.
Right, right. Kyle, what do you think?
I'm not sure if I want to see any specific changes. What I'd really love to see is a totally new product that works for more people, I think. I think this is a great way to convince Tesla lovers, EV enthusiasts to get a pickup truck. But I don't think it's really doing much in the way for getting pickup truck owners into electric. I'd really love to see something that's a little bit more traditional, that would work better off, you know, in rural environments where everyone drives a pickup truck here in the US. I would be super excited to see that. The Cybertruck's going to be really cool no matter what. I really hope they don't stray too far from their original design. I'm not one of the ones who loves it, but I really want to see Tesla hold their promise of showing, hey, we're going to make a cool wedge on wheels. And if they can pull that off and make it pass all the FMVSS and everything, that's going to be the big story here. So hopefully there's not too many changes. I think it will disappoint the fans of Tesla if they change it too much because people have fallen in love with this. What I'd love to see, again, is just a smaller, more usable, maybe not necessarily smaller, but more traditional styled pickup truck for the masses.
I think they're going to make a smaller one though, right? He said for international markets, because they said the big one, it's difficult to sell that in some territories, and maybe there might not be the interest in like a honking huge truck in a lot of places where, you know, people use you know, little small trucks, whatever. For myself, I think I came to the realization last night that I'm not so much a fan of the Cybertruck as I am the audacity of the Cybertruck, the willingness to put out such a design that looks like no other vehicle that really came before it. And well, with the exception of a few like high-end wedgie supercars like the Bulldog or some Aston Martins or whatever, Lotus.
I'm not sure the homologation is there for Europe, by the way. I know that this has been a hotly discussed topic, but the latest tweet that I saw from Elon, or that I recall from seeing from Elon Musk, was that it won't be available in Europe, and they're not planning on making changes to make it pass our crash tests in terms of pedestrian safety. Like the front end of that wouldn't pass the European pedestrian impact laws in a million years. So I gather that if they make a second Cybertruck, a smaller Cybertruck, that would be one aimed at the European market or rest of the world market, but only for homologation reasons. I mean, obviously we don't want such a massive truck over here, but I gather that the Cybertruck won't be. The information I'm working towards is that Cybertruck not on sale outside the USA. So if anyone has a reservation and they're watching this or listening to this and, you know, you're in the UK or whatever, then you're just giving Tesla an interest-free loan at the moment for your deposit. Not saying they won't do it one day, but I think it's a long way off.
Well, someone was having an exchange with Elon, I think yesterday or just recently. I was looking through his timeline there on Twitter, and someone was saying that they just need maybe an extra thing on their permit or an extra permit that allows them to drive a big truck. I don't know. Do you have any big trucks in Europe, like American pickup trucks?
Yeah, so the driving license rules changed. So I passed my test, and I'm still allowed to drive actually quite large vehicles. But then for newer drivers, I passed 20 plus years ago. So you know, time flies. But also, I don't think the Cybertruck would get into that category of being so big that people in their 20s couldn't drive it, for instance, that have passed their test in the last 10 years or so. I'm not aware that it's the size of the Cybertruck that's the issue. More about the just passing the homologation rules over here. But perhaps, you know, it's going to be such a big vehicle for them in terms of, you know, the potential. I do wonder whether they're able to do something to make it, but it would involve changing the look, the soul of the Cybertruck, actually, that front end. But I do wonder whether they could do something to make it work in multiple markets, because it seems odd as a global car company and all their other cars are sold around the world. Most car companies sell their cars around the world, depending on how many they produce and whether they've got to pass those, you know, not all of them have to pass crash testing and stuff, but it would seem weird for them to have a product on sale that isn't available in Europe, being it would be a big market, but nowhere as big as the US, of course.
Right. The only market I can think of, it, you know, outside of the US, you know, Canada and Australia, but if you made it in Australia, then you'd also have to put the steering wheel on the other side as well, which would, you know, be more expensive to produce. See, I don't know. If it was me, I would just like focus the big truck on the US market and then make a smaller version for the international market and maybe for the US market as well. Because, I mean, if I was looking for a Cybertruck, I would, depending on how much the smaller one looks like the bigger one, I would like to go for the smaller one, just because I don't need a big truck.
I agree too. I would, as you know, I have a reservation for the Cybertruck, but I would much prefer if it was in smaller form. I always have a pickup truck, as I've mentioned here on the show before. I need one for certain duties. I do snow plowing with properties I own, and so I always need a truck. But I always have like a Toyota Tacoma size vehicle. I don't need a big full size truck. But the prospect of having the Cybertruck was too alluring for me not to plunk down my refundable deposit. And to the point that you made earlier, Dominic, part of that was just to support the outrageousness of it. That, you know, it wasn't necessarily that I was in love with the form, which I think it's cool, but I love the fact that Tesla put out something that's just so ridiculous and outrageous that I want to support them for it. And I want the other auto manufacturers to see, look, people will buy wild, crazy things that look like concept cars. You don't just make them and put them on the show and then pull them back and give us something that's been toned down 10 times. We'll actually buy something that's outrageous if it's cool. So I think part of why I want to get one is just to kind of support that notion that, yeah, I'll buy something that's ridiculous and outrageous, you know, as long as it works and functions the way I need it to.
Right. And I can't wait till this thing is finally get built so we can kind of see, well, I want to see how it's built, you know, how it's put together using the skin as like sort of the frame or whatever. That's really even more than just like the little changes to whatever the appearance or like fixing the interior so it's like much more production ready. I just want to see what's going on with how they're in and how it's put together and how they're going to manufacture it en masse, you know. But but moving on, so look for the Model Y and the Model 3 to get better range and maybe charge faster in the future. According to information from recent lecture for the Stanford Storage X International Symposium, Panasonic's new 2170 battery cells not only offer greater energy density, but also have improved fast charging performance. So it's interesting that Panasonic is still working on the 2170 cell that's in the Model 3 and Model Y. And it's ready to, it's already started converting the Gigafactory production lines to produce them. Vice President of Battery Technology at Panasonic Energy of North America, Selena Mikolizak, or something, sorry, Selena, who used to work for Tesla and later Uber, spoke at the event. She said that Panasonic would increase the energy density of these battery cells by about 5%. And she also said the total volume output would increase by 10%. So that's good news for a Gigafactory. She also said these cells would offer excellent fast charge performance. So right now, the Model 3 gets 353 miles of EPA range, while the Model Y gets 326. Now, Tesla could keep the energy of these packs around the same number of kilowatt hours and make it maybe, I don't know, 5% lighter, which would improve range slightly and maybe acceleration and handling because less weight, basically. Or it could keep the same number of cells, which would effectively mean the pack would hold 5% more energy, and so we'll have about 5% more range, probably. That would take the Model 3, for example, up to 370 miles of EPA range. Kyle, which of these approaches would you prefer to take?
Well, I think maybe this is what we're seeing already. We've seen some speculation. Of course, Tom has one on order, one of these new Model 3s, the refresh. They come with new wheels, double pane glass, et cetera, new dashboard. And it is possible that some of this range improvement that we've seen with EPA comes from this new energy dense pack. Someone did the math. I haven't verified it, but they commented on one of our videos and they said that the pack actually has larger capacity based off of the efficiency given by the EPA than the current vehicles. So we can't wait to get our hands on one to test. This is something that might already be in the vehicles. If not, then we're just going to see it better. Which approach would I like? I think you go with the one that is most efficient, the lightest weight possible for the range. You know, I always say I think it's not always necessary to get the biggest battery on everything. I daily drive an electric smart car with 50 miles of EPA range, and I get around just fine. So I'd love to see them use the same number of cells that are higher energy dense and make a more holistic package. I think that would be that's everyone's goal. It's Lucid, you know, does this with their vehicles. They call it smart range or something like this instead of dumb range. Tesla has been doing a fantastic job of this from the beginning. They've been the leaders in efficiency in production vehicles up to this point. So I'd love to see that continue rather than just stuffing more batteries in the pack.
Right. What do you think, Tom?
Yeah, I'm definitely on board with Kyle here. You know, 353 miles of range with the supercharger network out there when you do need to charge is more than enough. I'm all for making the car lighter, more efficient. It'll even be quicker. Not that it needs to be quicker, but hey, can you ever be quick enough? So, you know, I definitely would, if it was my vote, I would, you know, make the car lighter, more efficient, not add the extra cells. 350 miles of range is just, you know, crazy. You know, with my previous one, I was 310 miles. EPA range rating. You know, I'd usually average a little bit less than that, but it was just more than what I ever needed. You know, I don't forget, I lived for nearly 10 years with a 100-mile electric car just fine. And were there sometimes a couple times a year where it was a little inconvenient or I needed to take the truck on a long trip? Yeah, that happened a few times, not as often as many people might think. But now that I've had the Model 3 for almost a year and a half, you know, it's just, whether it has 300 miles or 400 miles to me makes no difference. It doesn't make the car, the utility, any better. On my long trips with the supercharger network, you know, if it's a V3 supercharger, I get from 0% when I did my V3 supercharger test, from 0%, I got up to 50% charged in 12 minutes. And it was 80% charged in 28 minutes. So, you know, you're talking about 150, 175 miles in a 15-minute stop. I mean, you pull into the supercharger, you plug in, you walk inside to the whatever business is there, you grab a cup of coffee, maybe use the restroom, you come out 12 minutes later and you've got 175 miles of range. So to me, to add weight and more battery cells and make the car cost more so you can add an extra 50 miles on top of 350, it just doesn't make sense. So that's right. That's how I feel about it.
Yeah, and also that would keep the Model S as a more premium purchase with that psychological 400-mile barrier as well. So I think, you know, keep Model 3 at 350. You start to edge towards Model S, and you get back into that debate of what extra am I paying for before the S and the X get refreshed next year. So absolutely, the next frontier of EVs, or the next few years of EVs, I think we're going to see dominated by efficiency gains. Funnily enough, I was talking to an engineer this week as part of our podcast series with our tech partners AVL. Quick plug for that series to listen to.
Right.
Shameless plug on podcast and now on YouTube as well if you want to listen to those. But I was talking to one of the engineers there about wheels and bearings, and actually how there's a focus even on bearing efficiency. Like, if you can improve that efficiency by 25%, then the engineers are able to say, well, what do you want? Do you want 5 more horsepower or 10 more miles of range? You know, just to have a car that coasts, that there's just less friction driving. And so they're working on those kind of details. And I think that's going to be, we are joined by a fifth presenter on the podcast for our YouTube
that's
viewers.
That's Blue, I believe. Hi, Blue.
Hi, Blue.
Yes, Blue sits in chairs like a human.
Look, and I forget where I was, but none of it's important as Blue looking Kyle. And no, so I think, you know, like the next frontier is efficiency. And if we can make, because EVs are heavy, we can't get away from that, and that weight does impact range, impacts on how hardcore you have to build suspension components and all those, you know, how all those things, how heavy a car is. Actually, if you can, EVs are pretty heavy. If you can make them lighter. Right. By even just kilos and pounds at a time, you chip away at that. And that's going to be a really, really big next few years.
Definitely. I think, yeah, listen to Colin Chapman, add lightness.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Right. Right?
All right. So yeah, the other part of that about this was also the fast charge performance will improve as well. So I don't imagine it will, you know, it'll be able, there's no point of it being able to take more than 250 kilowatts of charge at the moment, because I think that's what the superchargers, version 3 superchargers, are limited at. But the knee of the charge, so it should charge or keep that, you know, higher rate of charge for longer, so your usual charging time will need to decrease by some amount, but we'll have to wait and see exactly how long that is. So I just got. We just have one other Tesla story, real quick, and it's. I'm not sure if you even want to discuss this too much, but I thought I'd bring it up. Tesla has been getting a lot of love in Germany. The Berlin Gigafactory is coming along quite nicely, and it seems like Elon is having something of a bromance with Volkswagen CEO Hermann Diess. Still, the automaker hit a rough patch this week, getting fined 12 million euros by the German Umweltbundesamt. Maybe the Federal Environment Agency for not living up to its battery take back obligations. So in Germany, all manufacturers are required to take care of end of life battery products in the case of electric vehicles, those might be faulty batteries or old batteries or packs damaged in accidents. Tesla, of course, does take back batteries, but they seem to have run afoul of some administrative requirements somehow. So they have filed an objection, but they will comply with the final judgment, of course, and not really a big deal in the whole scheme of things. You know, 12 million euros is, you know, enough to get their attention, I'm sure. I thought it was at least mentioning, though. Anyone want to comment on this?
Only that the point that Tesla seems to be making is that they didn't do anything wrong, like by not recycling or having second use for the batteries. It was just that their claim is that they didn't follow the proper administrative course of action. So it could be just paper filings that weren't completed. But I mean, that's just Tesla's response. We don't know if that's the truth. But I think that's, you know, important enough to make a point that people realize Tesla's just saying, hey, we didn't do anything wrong. Perhaps we didn't file the proper paperwork.
Yeah, they dropped the ball in some respect, for sure. So other big news this week is going back to Germany. BMW announced that it has an all-electric architecture coming, but maybe only in 2025. Tom, do you have some details about this?
Yeah, so as soon as I heard this, I put a smile to my face, and I have to go back, you know, years to start why that is. Many people on Inside EVs and in other places on the internet used to know me as like the BMW EV guy. And that's because I was in BMW's Mini E program since 2009. And then I was in their Active E program. And I was actually a very visual, vocal member of that group. And BMW seized on that and kind of used me in some of their marketing. They made a couple of documentaries where I was one of the primary characters. They made YouTube videos that I'm in. So I was kind of known as the BMW EV guy for many years. This is 2009 through, say, 2013 or 14, right up to when the i3 launched. Now, of course, when they had a commercial product that they were selling to everyone, they didn't need like a non-official EV ambassador anymore. Now they had, you know, thousands of people driving their production cars and buying them. But during that period, I got to know so many people in BMW's EV program in Munich and here in the US, right up to the board of directors. I've had dinner with board members from BMW in Munich. So, you know, I was a prominent member of this and got to know a lot of people and got to pick their brains on EVs. Now, early on when BMW started what they called Project I back in right around 2007-ish, they determined early on that electric vehicles were going to be the next big automotive shift and that they needed to start getting serious about them. And that's why they started these pilot programs back in 2008. One of the things that they determined was these vehicles need a dedicated platform. That was what their assessment was. Electric vehicles, in order to be the best they can, they need a dedicated platform. So BMW started working on dedicated platform for the i3 and i8. They started BMW i, and these vehicles were going to have all dedicated electric vehicle platforms. Now at the time, BMW CEO Rutherford was a big proponent of this, and he had the clout within the company to invest billions of dollars, to okay the investment of billions of dollars into this, you know, the carbon fiber, building out a factory, you know, that was gonna be able to make these dedicated platforms and putting a ton of money behind this. Now, when Rutherford stepped down in 2015 and Kruger took over, there was an internal shift. There was a power struggle on what type of platform they need to build. And also, how quickly the shift to electrification was going to happen. And the bean counters and the people that were very, very, you know, they were growing tired of the billions that BMW had invested over, you know, the previous five or six years, and they were getting very little returns on. They weren't selling many i3s, they weren't selling many i8s, and they were just pouring money. They looked at it as pouring money into a black hole. Now, this is firsthand that I'm getting from numerous BMW high-level managers. many of which are no longer with BMW now. They went on to work in other companies. They decided when Kruger took over, there was this big power shift, and they kind of pressured him to scale back on electrification, that this wasn't going to happen as fast as we thought. So I think the best thing to do is dump these dedicated platforms. Let's go to this flexible architecture where on the same production lines, we can make ICE vehicles, we can make plug-in hybrid vehicles, and we can make battery electric vehicles. The cars are going to look the same. This architecture is going to be able to handle both. And they came out and announced that at the LA Auto Show in 2017, which I was at. And I had a chance to interview multiple electric BMW product managers. There's some posts up on the Inside EVs site right while I was at the 2017 LA Auto Show. And that's when they came out with this giant presentation about the flexible architecture, and we're going to shift from dedicated platforms. You know, we're going to make this architecture. And at the same time, you know, half the people I talked to at BMW were looking at me. They can't say anything, but they were just rolling their eyes. And I was kind of, you know, dumbfounded at this, because for 5-6 years, all I've been hearing from them is the only way to build electric vehicles is have a dedicated platform. It's no compromises. I mean, they use that in their marketing back then. No compromises, pure electric driving enjoyment, you know, the ultimate electric vehicle, all this stuff. Now all of a sudden, I think the best way to go is to make these, you know, we can make a platform that can accommodate everything. Now, you know, pretty much everybody in the industry understands that if you do that, all of the vehicles are compromised. The gas vehicles are compromised, the plug-in hybrid vehicles and the fully electric cars are compromised, because the platform wasn't specifically designed for that type of a build. Can it handle it? Yeah. Does it do it okay? Yeah, it does. It does a pretty good job at it, but you'll never be able to completely optimize that vehicle. So now this is 2017. They come out with this announcement. You know, Kruger's the CEO. He only lasted for a few years. Last year, Zipsy took over, and all of a sudden now we're hearing, well, maybe we shouldn't have done that. You know, they would never say that. But now they're saying, okay, you know, we're going to run this flexible architecture that we've been talking about up until 2025. We're going to introduce our new next generation, all electric, dedicated platforms. And it really seems to me like, you know, the BMW's had this bipolar, strategy in the last 15 years, where we need dedicated platforms. We don't need dedicated platforms. We need dedicated platforms. Make up your mind and do it the right way. And pretty much every major auto manufacturer has acknowledged the way to build electric vehicles properly is to use a ground up platform, dedicated design. And that's the way you optimize it. You make it most efficient. You get the most miles out of it. And to be honest with you, it's the best for crash worthiness when the entire vehicle is just designed for that one type of powertrain. So looks like they've finally come around, but this company had what I considered been a leader in electrification, you know, 10, 12 years ago, and they're trying to catch up now. And that's, it's unfortunate.
Right. Kyle, do you have some thoughts on this?
I'm the biggest BMW fan there ever was. And like Tom was saying, when we started to see this flexible approach, I really thought all of the products in general just started to go a little bit downhill. Their M cars got soft. Their normal cars were just way too cushy. I was like, you know, BMWs were always the ultimate driving machine. Then they kind of lost their way. And now with the electric thing, they started so great with the i3, right? We've owned three of them. I have one charging in the garage right now. It's one of my all-time favorite quirky engineering marvels of a vehicle that I love. And then now they were like, okay, we'll just make a car that can run on everything. And it's like, no, don't do that. And so, you know, I really hope to see more dedicated platforms from BMW in the future. This new 4 Series could be something, the i4. We'll start seeing what they're going to be doing with this integration and how the future will look as a standalone system. But I really hope the best for them, because my perception is BMW is quite behind in electrification right now. They really need to push from behind. If they had just continued with the i3 when they were so far ahead, they would be right up there with almost anyone at this point, but they have a lot of groundwork to make up.
I mean, they have continued somewhat with the i3. They've increased the battery size over the years, and I mean, it's still the same car.
Yeah, but it's not enough. I mean, you can go and spend $55,000 or $60,000 on an i3s that only does 150 miles of range, or you can go and buy a $35,000 Model 3 that blows it away in every metric and is just as usable. So right. I think they should just. Look, as much as I love the i3, we know they're going to stop production on it soon. No one's buying them. It doesn't make sense to buy them new. The lease deals are amazing, but that's really the only way it makes sense to get one of those things. And we just need to see them make some serious, serious EVs. iX3 looks pretty good. Granted, it's on a traditional chassis, but looks nice. Auto Gefühl just did a review on this, and they said that they were extremely impressed and blown away, Thomas, over there. So that was pretty good.
Right. Yeah, I was going to mention the iX3 getting some good reviews, and that's for China and Europe, I guess. Martin, you have any news on that? Yeah.
Oh, the iX3.
Just real quick.
So it got good reviews. A good review from Auto Gefühl, and he was pretty impressed with it. Impressed with the build quality. It felt like a BMW. Felt good to drive. The driving section of it. He was pretty happy on the motorways, and it felt like a BMW handling car. But as Tom says, like ultimately, if you are getting to the point of having to stuff batteries underneath the back seat and trying to put things where you can fit them, but also having to have a car that has enough room up front for a combustion engine, and we know how big engines are and complex and, you know, crazy good engineering they are, albeit last century, but if you have to leave room for that up front, but actually that's not where you would put a battery. So the whole car is essentially a compromise. And I feel for BMW because they've said for so long, this is the way to do it. Now look, their money, not mine. I respect the power of choice thing that they that's how they've chosen to work their factories, build the iX3, looks like a combustion car. Their focus groups probably told them, you know, I don't want to buy an EV because it'll look like a Prius. So their focus groups probably told them, I want to buy an EV that looks like a conventional car. So they went away and they did that. You know, Steve Jobs famously never used focus groups before the iPhone was launched because he always said, well, people don't know what they don't know. Just make a great product and show it to them. They might want that. So I think that's the case with EVs. If you say to people, you know, what do you want? They say, well, I don't want to look some crazy, funky looking car. Just I like my X3 or my X5. So they've gone away and done that. And, you know, like I say, their money, not mine. Their factories, they've got to fund it. They've got to fund the next 5 or 10 years. And they thought that actually making all these cars on one chassis in the same factory was the best way to do it. And it turns out that they've gone back to the drawing board and gone, you know what, guys, we have an idea. Actually, start with a blank piece of paper, put a battery underneath, low center of gravity, packaged really nicely. And then on top of that, you can put almost any body shape. Like the MEB platform that VW are doing, that's going from very small, well, pretty small compact cars all the way through to kind of big surf buses and vans and seven-seaters. And so I feel for them. Does anybody, you know, does any customer really care? Like, I feel that the next 5 years are going to be a struggle for BMW. I feel that from now till they launch this new platform, they're implicitly saying, this is not our best work. Like, please buy the BMW iX3, but it's not how we really want. Like, that press release we showed up on screen a minute ago says, a dedicated platform is the optimum. That was the word that he used, you know, the optimum. So, in other words, the next 5 years worth of cars are going to be suboptimum. So buy our less good stuff, but wait, because in 5 years, the real deal arrives. In the meantime, you could buy the real deal now. You could buy a VW-based or any of the VW group cars based on a dedicated platform. You could buy a Tesla and others as well. So, you know, but does anybody really care? Is that just us because we're nerdy about EVs? Will anybody walk into a dealership and go, oh, well, this is last year's technology. Like, nobody really cared that the, right. you know, the Mini that came out was with the i3 technology. Well, bits of it, that it wasn't their cutting edge tech. Did anybody care? Because 16,000 people have bought a Mini and they probably all love them. So maybe I overthink it. Maybe I'm getting too in the weeds of this. But I do feel that actually, long term, they've made the right decision. Short term, every time we talk about one of their new cars, we're going to say, oh, this is great. The i4 is great. The iNext, which is revealed on the 11th. You know, that's great, but not what they're going to be doing long term. This is an interim solution now. So I don't know how they navigate that, but does anybody care?
No. So, Martin, so you're probably right about does anybody care, but they do care that the range on the iX3 isn't great. And it would be better if it was a dedicated platform with a skateboard, if they could have put in a larger battery. They could have made the vehicle look exactly the same. You know, if people want a normal, quote unquote, looking BMW, the car could have looked exactly the same, but it would have had a bigger battery with longer range. It would have had a flat floor, so there'd be more interior room, and it could have a big frunk up front for more cargo space. So, you know, basically they didn't have to sacrifice the looks. It just would have been a better iX3. Now this iX3 might be very good, but it could have been better with a dedicated platform. That's really the point.
I think for the US and European markets, we'll be very happy to see the iNext come along, and the i4. I think both those cars, even though they're on the flexible platform, you know, they both look pretty promising. I'm not seeing the range rate off the top of my head, but I think they're pretty good. Yes? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I'm talking about to see the i4 for sure, and see, you know, all of its performance specs and range and whatnot. So I don't think, and we have to drill down to this point. I think Martin and Kyle all agree here. It doesn't mean they're going to be terrible cars on this flexible platform. They might be very good cars, but they could be better. And that's the point. It would be optimized. They would be better if they had a dedicated platform. They'd be more efficient. They probably have more range, and you can just package the vehicle better to have more cargo space. It's just a better vehicle, and it's unfortunate that they chose to go down this path and make compromised vehicles.
Yeah, I think we can agree that in order to make the ultimate driving machine, electric driving machine, you need to start from the bottom with, you know, a base that's, you know, engineered to be specifically to be an electric vehicle. That's, you know, basically it.
The range on the iNext is going to be 600 kilometers, which is what they mentioned on the earnings call, where that press release I just showed you.
And like that 350 miles?
372 miles. So, well, that's WLTP, European 600 Ks, 372 miles. That's good. But the problem that they're going to have is to get that, they're going to have to put in a battery that is so much bigger than they could have if they designed the car, around being an efficient EV. And so I'll just pull numbers out of the air. They might put in a 110 kilowatt hours when they could have put in 90, you know, if they'd done it optimally. But that 20 kilowatt hours is, you know, every five cars they built, you know, they could have got one free. That's bottom line, that's margin, that's investment, that's resources that we have to dig out of the ground. If efficiency is part of building an EV from the ground up. So I think it'll have good specs. I think it'll be a great car, but we'll know a nagging doubt it could have been better, as Tom says.
Right. Well, speaking of automakers who had an early lead in electrification and then kind of let it get away from them, if you've been dying to reserve one of the first Nissan Ariya electric crossover SUVs to come off the line, you're in luck. In private messages on Facebook, it seems Nissan has told future customers that pre-orders should open for it before the end of the year. And seeing as we're already deep into November, or not deep into November, but in November, that's still pretty soon. The Ariya should start deliveries in Japan beginning in mid-2021 and before going to other markets. I feel like it's going to be up against some stiff competition with the Tesla Model Y and the Ford Mustang Mach-E. So it will be interesting to see what kind of response Nissan gets from potential customers, you know, the number of pre-orders and such. And that will help them too with their planning for the vehicle. the company really needs a solid hit with this new technology. Martin, are you tempted by the Ariya?
No. Well, it's okay. Yes, I think they haven't just made the Leaf a little bit better. Which was the potential. They could have gone, it's the new Leaf. But they didn't. They went away. They made a dedicated platform that is a custom EV. And, you know, we can see that coming through with things like the 22 kilowatt onboard charging on AC, over-the-air updates built into it from the very core of the vehicle. Two battery sizes on the Ariya, so 63 and 87 kilowatt hours. So a choice of two again, which you can offer up to 310 miles of range. The key with the Nissan is it's never going to be a premium purchase. Is what price do they come in at? What lease deals are out there? So if people are thinking, now, what am I going to get for 310 miles? Is it going to be a Model 3? Is it going to be the Nissan Ariya? It's going to be, well, what's going to be my monthly payment? For most people, not for everyone, but what's it going to cost me to do motoring per month? And again, much like the VWs, we talked a lot, we have been effusive about the ID4 because it's just good enough, or it ticks all the right boxes to keep the cost down. So this 130 kilowatt charge speeds, not going to break any records, but as good as you need to get. So, you know, not the biggest battery, but who needs more than 300 miles? So I think it looks pretty good as well. So good luck. Yeah. Good luck to them. I suspect the top specs, the biggest battery and the top specs are going to start off very expensive and you end up out of Nissan territory on this, which is where, you know, the Leaf... 62 kilowatt hour, I think, suffers from. Like, oh, actually, Kyle, you've driven the new Leaf. It's not a cheap, the big battery Leaf, not a cheap car. You end up getting into the territory of, well, just get something else.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. It's 45 grand, but we get like $10,000 off at the dealer. You get $7,500 federal, and in my state here, $4,000 off in Tom's state, $5,000. I'm spending this week with the Ariya, which will be very interesting. I think I'm the first one to get to do so in the U.S., and so I'll be spending a full day with it, and or at least a portion of a day, and we're going to play around with it, see what it's like. I'm going to beg them to let me drive it, although I believe it's going to be just in studio. So yeah, that'll be kind of cool. I have an exciting week with cool EVs, and this is one of them. And I think it's going to be a hot car, but as Martin says, it needs to be priced right, especially on a lease. This car needs to be $300, $350, $400 a month, somewhere around there, and they will sell buckets of them. If it's a $400 plus proposition, just go lease a Model Y.
In some respects, I kind of, you know, but everyone has the Model Y, and Tesla's a big name. I think Nissan can really carve themselves out a niche here especially if the interior has like a premium feel. I mean, not necessarily, you know, super expensive, but just the design is, you know, feels, you know, premium. And yeah, and I forgot to mention that it's also up against the Volkswagen ID4, which is, that might be its closest competition. I don't know.
Yeah, but Dominic, you have to keep in mind, there has been not one example of a Nissan product that feels premium, even including Infiniti products. They all feel super cheap. They're terrible on the inside. You hit plastics. The only reason you buy an Infiniti is because you can't afford the BMW or Mercedes. So, you know, why would you get an Ariya and spend more than a Volkswagen, for example? Because Volkswagens, although they are relatively reasonably priced, always feel really solid. So I am really hoping to be blown away here, but I'm coming in with marginal expectations as to what to expect from Ariya this week.
Oh, we need to talk more because I didn't know you were going to see that this week. That's kind of exciting. Like, is it going to be, where are you going to go see it at?
I have to go to Los Angeles to go there to see it.
Okay.
Yeah, it's on Wednesday, the 10th. Whatever day is November 10th is when I'm going to be there. I haven't looked yet. I also haven't booked any flights yet, so I need to get all that in order.
Wow, that's pretty exciting. So I guess they're going to let you inside of it?
Yeah, I guess I have full access. I'm really going to beg them to let me drive it as well. They didn't say no yet, at least, so we'll see. And yeah, I mean, look, it looks good. All the specs look good. It really just comes down to what's the lease going to be on this thing. You know, that's because true, it's not an emotional like a connecting vehicle. Like when you look at a Mini, for example, you feel a happy soul, something exciting. When you see a Porsche, you know that this is bred from years of perfection of carving corners and tracks. And when you look at this, it just looks like a lot of angles with no real meaning or passion. And this is totally my take. Someone could feel totally differently. Personally, it just doesn't do anything for me.
Right. Yeah, I'm not really sold on the front end of this, but I'm not really sold on the front of, the ID4 as well. You know, I do kind of like most of the rest of it. And I've driven the drivetrain of this in a Leaf sort of thing. They had a all-wheel drive Leaf, and so I got to see how dynamically it was. You know, it's going to have a lot of power, and they've done a lot of work with like torque vectoring and things. So it should be a very interesting vehicle to drive once it's all done. And I'm not sure if that'll be in the prototype. If you do to get a chance to drive it, if it'll have that full drivetrain already worked up, but I guess we'll find out.
Yeah, look, I'm going to really do my best to get as much coverage as possible, really go into this, you know, hoping to be impressed, but I'm not, you know, based off of Nissan's track record so far, it hasn't been amazing. So I'm, you know, they haven't updated the Leaf in forever. So I think I'm just coming off a bad experience with the Leaf E+ because of just battery thermal throttling. Of course, this will be liquid cooling, and I'm going to try to approach it with a super open mind and look at this compared to ID4, because that's really what it's going to be going up against. It's the non-Tesla, non-luxury segment, you know, sort of value-based crossover that sort of ticks all the right boxes. And, you know, it's got to compete with ID4, no question.
Yeah.
So for me, I've driven the ID4, and I'm really trying to figure out where Nissan is going to get customers for this in the U.S. Between the ID4, the Model Y, and say the Mustang Mach-E, this is my fourth choice of a compact crossover, and I'm only one person, but you know, I've driven in those three vehicles and, you know, impressed by all of them. And, you know, I'm just trying to figure out where Nissan fits in with this. And does Nissan really get behind it? Do they market it? Do they, you know, spend time training their dealers on pushing this vehicle? Or does it sit in the back of the lot and, you know, only gets dragged out when somebody comes in and demands to drive one, you know, which we've seen that in some markets with the Leaf. So, you know, how Nissan approaches this vehicle is going to really play a big role in how well it does. We know Volkswagen is going to get behind the ID4. You know, I do work with dealerships, and I'm already seeing, you know, that Volkswagen is starting to get the dealers ready and excited about the vehicle. So, you know, and it's a very important vehicle for Volkswagen. So I fully expect them to really get behind it. I think we're going to see commercials, advertisements. I think you're going to walk into Volkswagen dealerships and see posters and all kind of literature for the ID4. You know, is Nissan going to do that with the Ariya? I know Ford is getting behind the Mustang Mach-E. So, you know, you've got the Model Y, which, you know, Tesla doesn't even have to promote. You've got Ford really getting behind the Mustang Mach-E. For crying out loud, they gave it the Mustang name. They better get behind it. And we know Volkswagen's going to really push the ID4. So where does that leave Nissan with this vehicle? Unless it's a fantastic value proposition, which it kind of doesn't seem that way yet. Like Kyle was talking to, you know, Nissan's almost going to have to, you know, make some really, really good lease terms in order to move any kind of volume of these. I don't see it happening. I like it. I think it's a great improvement, a great step in the right direction for Nissan. But it's got some tough competition, and I think it's going to, you know, basically come in last in that category.
Yeah, I feel like Nissan is like in a tight spot. I mean, they've been struggling a bit, I think, over the last little while, you know, problems with upper management and, yeah, all kinds of craziness. But like, if you think about it, electrification wise, the Ariya is really the only thing they've been showing. That's it. It's the Leaf, which is going away, and then there's electric Ariya, and what else are they going to do? Could they use this platform for another vehicle? You'd think they'd have two or three kind of, you know, they'd be talking about in the background, ready to go for say a year on from this or so, but nothing. Maybe Kyle, you can see if they have something else in about their sleeves.
Yeah, I'll be pushing them on all that good stuff. No question.
Right. I mean, because they have a platform, they can't just use it for one vehicle, right?
I don't know. Nissan's made some questionable decisions before, so this might be another one. We'll see.
Yeah. Alrighty. So, okay, moving along to the next thing. Kandi EVs have been approved by the EPA for U.S. roads. Kyle, he looks pretty excited about this. So, yeah. So, in California, it's been also been approved for road use, and they effectively start at $8,000 there for the K27, which is the smaller one. K24 is the bigger one. Kyle, I think you might be... Are you going to drive one of these things soon?
This week, this is another one of the EVs this week, and this one's in Dallas, so I'm doing a lot of traveling this week. And so, yeah, great news. It got approved by the EPA. It makes no emissions anyway. I don't know why that's a story, but here's the deal. This thing is rad. I can buy one new for $6,000 in Colorado, and it's just like... so awesome that, like, I looked up the price of an Easy Go golf cart, and they're $13,000 for a lithium one. So I could have two Kandis and play golf with them instead of one Easy Go, and it goes farther, it goes faster, and it's approved. I could put a license plate on it and drive it on the street. That's just the icing on the cake. The fact that this thing comes with four wheels for $6,000 is really amazing. So yeah, I'm going to drive one this week. I don't know what to expect. I'm pretty sure you can buy a identical version of this on Alibaba, and it's just branded with a Kandi badge. I have no idea, but I'm gonna meet the CEO. I'm gonna go do the whole, you know, round and round, and you can tell it's their first time launching a vehicle. They're not sure what to expect. I'm the first journalist that's not been paid to say nice things about it to go drive it. And they're like, well, you know, you have to understand it's not a Tesla. It doesn't have a lot of, I'm like, look, I daily drive a $30,000 smart car that goes 50 miles on a charge. This is better in every measurable category. And I kind of already like it, but I'm going to be super objective about it. You know, what I'm really curious about is, can this thing, you know, drive on the highway safely? I know its top speed is in the 60 mile per hour range, 68, I think. But is it feel like it's going to fall apart there? Because if it does, then this just knocks it out for most U.S. commuters. You know, we hop on the highway for a few exits at least. So it has to feel comfortable at those speeds. I'm looking forward to it. And if you want to see anything specific on the Kandi EV while I'm testing it, go in the comments down below, and before Wednesday, I'll make sure to answer the questions that we receive.
Right on.
Yeah. Kyle, one second. I take offense to the comment about this is better in every measurable way than your smart car, okay? Because I've driven in your smart car, and I challenge you to take this piece of Kandi and drive it on your course at your track like you drive your smart car. And I mean doing the jumps, you know, going over potholes, driving it through the woods. This thing would disintegrate in half a day, and you've been driving your smart car like that for years. The people listening here have to find some of Kyle's videos he's done on his and put on his it should be on Out of Spec, right, Kyle? That has you off-roading on the electric smart. I almost want to buy one of these and give it to you so you can do that and just watch the thing like just disintegrate on the first day. There's no way this thing could hold up. One thing about the smart car that we can all agree on, that thing is built like a tank. Mercedes did a fantastic job building that car. It's one of the strongest cars I think available today, which you would never think looking at it, but it's true. It's like a giant roll cage, you know, like a giant steel roll cage on four wheels. So, you know, while this Kandi might be a fantastic value, before we put it in the smart category, let's let somebody drive it for a couple of years and see how it holds up.
Right. I totally agree, Tom. So what we're looking at now is my first electric smart car, which was actually my first electric car. The one I have now is the next generation, but they're both just as strong. This car, actually, we just tore apart, and it's now used for stationary battery storage at my friend's house because it had an onboard charger error, so the battery bricked. Tom, I agree. I actually think I'm going to get one for a one-year long-termer. I'm going to buy it. And, just do a very, do as many things as I can do with the cheapest new car you can buy. And I would just want to take it skiing up in the mountains. You know, we live in Colorado now, and just, put the skis on the roof and tow stuff with it. I think it'd be so fun just to do whatever is possible with a Kandi K27.
Kyle, if you want, I'll pay half.
Perfect. We're going in on this then.
But here's the thing. After you from your initial choices, I want to get it first for say 6 months or 8 months or whatever, because I know once you get it, you're going to freaking destroy it. So I can't.
That's true.
You've driven it. That's how you're going to drive it, like with that smart car. And I'll get you do all your initial videos and stuff. Then give it to me for a few months. I'm not going to do this with it. I'll just do some cool videos, charging and stuff, and just drive it around for a while. And then you can get it and just destroy it if you want. If this thing's only going to cost $6,000 or $7,000, like you said, I'll kick in 50% of that, and we'll split it.
Okay, that sounds like a really fun thing. It'd be fun to get one or two. I'd kind of like to get a fleet of them and play soccer with them. Just get a giant soccer ball in a field and run the Kandis everywhere. So many endless possibilities with a cheap and cheerful vehicle. And it comes with a warranty. That's the crazy thing. I just can't get over the value. The fact that it might even drive on the road is just a bonus.
As soon as you post your first video, the warranty is going to be void. Okay. Just
Yeah, I agree. I'm not going to have a warranty.
So maybe you can find out the answer to this here for us, Kyle. So it's been approved by the EPA for US roads, but what about the National Highway Transportation Safety, whatever, NHTSA.
Yeah, NHTSA. I don't know. I'll ask them all of that, how they're planning on crash testing them. Are they able to get around them? Because some low-volume cars like Koenigseggs or real nice cars don't need to necessarily be crash tested. So I don't know what category they're filing under. The vehicle runs on highway speeds. It's not a neighborhood electric vehicle, so I imagine it has to go through the same safety specs that a Mercedes S-Class would have to go through. What the specs will be, I don't know. But I am definitely going to get all the answers. Another question, I think a big question here, is what about service? Because they're a power sports company originally. They've made electric jet skis, electric boats, things like this. Are they going to work with those power sport dealerships to sell Kandis, or are they going to build up their own service and sales network? I think we'll have to wait and see, but I'll definitely do my best to get the whole round picture on this car. But you just can't get over the value to buy one as a toy, to go to Starbucks in the morning. I think we're going to see a lot of, two types of buyers. Buyers that are very price conscious, that just need a city vehicle once in a while, and then other buyers that, have the Model S in the garage, have the Model X, have a Taycan, and this is just the little fun toy to play around with. And I think we'll see quite a lot of that, actually.
Yeah, it would be a great, just get around the city car for very price conscious buyers. But man, it's cheaper than a golf cart, but it's probably as safe as a golf cart too.
It goes a lot farther, a lot faster, and the safety is a big question. Hopefully I don't test that out during my time with it this week, but I am going to be the first one to drive it. We are going to be producing a lot of videos. We'll have a full first drive here on the Inside EVs YouTube channel this week. It's going to go up right after we drive the car. That's our top priority, because I think this could really be a huge story for electric vehicle buyers in the U.S. It could be just someone dipping their toes in the water, but just the price is insane. So, of course, we'll do out-of-spec reviews, out-of-spec motoring, and so on and so forth. I'd love to get one for a one lap as well, but maybe we have to wait till we buy one.
Right on. Hey, okay, so let's move along a little bit. I guess we're already at the hour, so let's hit some the remaining stories a little quick, some of them. So if you followed me on Twitter, or my work at previous websites, you'll know that I'm a big fan of electric motorcycles. I like the engineering challenge they present, get enough batteries for decent range and limited space for one. So this week, Voxan, that's V-O-X-A-N, set 11 new electric speed records with its Wattman motorcycle. So a little background real quick. Voxan was a French brand. It started in 1995, gas-powered motorcycles, and they had gone bankrupt by 2009. And then they got picked up by Guido Pastor, who is the head of the electric vehicle company Venturi. And it might be worth noting here that Venturi actually had an electric sports car called the Fetish in 2008, around the same time as the Tesla Roadster. But at $465,000, it didn't sell many, or possibly none. It's a bit unclear, really. But anyway, so Voxan first debuted the Wattman at the Paris Motorcycle Show, or Le Salon de la Moto, si tu parles français, in December of 2013. The original bike boasted about 200 horsepower, but it was also huge, with a 12.8 kilowatt hour battery, and weighed 771 pounds, about 350 kilograms. So Guido Pastor then moved to the US shortly after that, and Voxen seemed to be put on hold, and he was really putting a lot of his time into Formula E, really, with the Venturi team. But then last year it came out that the famed motorcycle racer Max Biaggi was working with Voxen with the goal of setting some speed records. Originally, I read that the goal was to hit like 205 miles an hour or so on the Uyuni salt flats in Bolivia. But then 2020 happened, so plans were changed. So I'm not sure exactly how they changed, but they definitely did. If we fast forward to last Saturday, Biaggi set 11 different records on three different versions of the bike, which each looks quite different, but better than the original Wattman, which was, had some challenge stylistically, let's say. So I won't read you all the different results, but they're on our Rider Part motorcycle site if you're interested. But they broke a record in the partially streamlined electric motorcycle over 300 kilogram class with a 228.05 mile an hour result. That's 366.94 kilometers an hour. That's the average of two runs in opposite directions. But the top speed they hit at the Châtellerault airfield in France was 254 miles an hour, or 408 kilometers an hour. So from the sounds of it, they might go for some even higher speeds in the future, but unfortunately, there is unlikely to be a Voxen motorcycle for sale anytime soon. Now, I don't know if anyone wants to talk about this at all, but yeah, I hear crickets. No, okay, that's fine. So another big piece of news this week was Bentley has announced that it will be fully electric by 2030, which is big news. They've been they make V12s over there, Kyle?
V8s, V12s.
Right, and they've been around for like 100 years or so.
W12s, they're two V6s bolted together at the crank.
That's right. Yeah, but Bentley makes some great cars, the Flying Spur, they make the Continental, some great, they don't call their cars convertibles. What do they call their roofless cars?
I don't know, but if you want a cheap Bentley, you can buy one for like 40 grand, get a Continental, just get some 26-inch wheels. It's probably got them on there anyway, and you will be an instant baller, Ron, riding around in a W12 convertible Continental GT for like, again, less than a new Nissan Ariya.
Right. Hey, so Bentley is a Volkswagen brand. So it's, they didn't really talk about, by 2030, they did show us, if you're looking at watching this on YouTube, they did show us this EXP100 concept. So I'm not sure if that's the first thing they're going to bring to us or not. If they do, it's likely going to be on, so Bentley is part of the Volkswagen group. So it would be on the PPE platform, I believe, for the premium platform electric that Audi and probably Porsche, I guess, are going to be using. So yeah, but that's a pretty big deal. I mean, that's a luxury brand. It's pretty, high end, way up there, all electric. It's sending a message.
Yeah, you've got to remember as well, there is absolutely no, room for nostalgia in the new VW. I think they are, I mean, not ruthless. They're not exactly just going to close it down or just sell it off. But if you are part of that group now, you have to have a clear electric plan, and there is no room for having things in the trophy cabinet that are nice. Like VW have got some things in the trophy cabinet that like are nice to have, but don't really, you know, where are they ever going to go? And so if Bentley are going to stick around within that group, they have to have a very clear electric future. So from 2026, all electrified models, well, with a plug socket, and by 2030, no more engines. That's about as clear.
And you have to keep in mind, electrification fits this class of vehicle perfectly. The Bentley owners are not the type to go just drive cross country. They're cruising around town. They want the most luxurious, quiet, comfortable experience. And that fits perfectly with the characteristics of a battery electric drivetrain. So I am all for this. I think that EXP100 looks amazing, and really, really can't wait to see what Bentley does with this, because especially for luxury vehicles, the packaging of electric drivetrains on an all-electric platform means you can do some really interesting things on the interior of the car. So it's really allowing designers to get creative again and really make some interesting looking vehicles, because, you know, Bentleys have always looked good, but now they might be able to look great again.
Yeah. You know who's not going to be great again for a while? Ferrari. I just say that because they came out this, their chairman or something came out this weekend said they didn't see an electric Ferrari anytime soon or ever.
Yeah. Camilleri said that it's that Ferrari will never be full electric. And in fact, he, CEO, he said he couldn't even see a time where they were 50% electric, which is probably, again, this was on, much like BMW news that we told you earlier, this was on a investor call. These are people whose hard-earned money is put into a company. And, you know, sometimes people want to hear what they want to hear. So you got to look in the context as where, you know, what was said, but also, this is a company that can't mislead investors, and so they can't just say it and not really mean it. But still, I mean, what? Where do you go with that? He can't see a 50% share of their cars, and they will never be an electric brand, he said. Well, you don't get to be CEO of Ferrari without being a smart guy, and so he knows in the future all transport is going to be zero emission. It's when it happens, like you and I know that, but it's. Like, it's when that, is it going to be 10 years or 12 or 15 or 8? So to say Ferrari will never be fully electric is saying Ferrari's going away. And they're not going away. They're too good at making money and putting their logos on baseball caps and lunchboxes and key rings. So they're too good at making money. They're not going to close down. But that's a crazy thing to say. Ferrari will be a zero emission brand one day in the future. Or they'll be a very, very niche brand selling 100 cars a year and getting around regulations and emissions things as a collector's item. That's not going to happen.
Yeah, I can't.
Whenever people make never statements, this will never happen, that will never happen, they usually don't age well. You know, we were talking a little bit earlier about when I was at the 2017 LA Auto Show and talking with the BMW reps there and kind of like flabbergasted that they're making this shift and going to do this variable, flexible platform. I also had the opportunity to speak with somebody who was very high up in BMW M division at the time. I don't know if it was the US product manager for M. I forget who exactly it was. And I remember them telling me, BMW M will never be electric. You'll never see an M logo on a BMW EV. Because at the time, some people may remember this, I had an i3 that I wrapped red, and I put a BMW M tag on the back of it. So it said MI3. And I remember when I was at the show, he came up to me in a German accent, said, and I didn't even know who he was at the time, but I was standing there with BMW blog creator, you know, the owner of BMW blog, Horacio Baroque. And he said, Mr. Mulogany. And yes, I looked at him, he goes, you have something of mine. And I was like, okay, what is that? And Horacio started laughing. He said, you put an M badge on the i3. And I just smiled. He said, it doesn't belong there. It hasn't earned it. He said, I want you to take it off. And he was serious. And he was serious. And we had a conversation. And at the time, he said, the BMW M, we'll never, make an M car. One of the electric cars will never be an M BMW. And I kind of chuckled about it and said, I wish I was recording this because I'd love to play it later. But, they take that serious, the M division, and the cars that, and I understand, if your car hasn't earned it, if it's not an M, you shouldn't put it on there. But I did it as a joke. I wasn't trying to say, oh, this is an M car. I did it to fool people because at the time I wrapped my i3 red. You couldn't get an i3 in red at the time. It just had all these boring colors. So I had this red i3, so it already looked different. And then with the M tag on the back, people actually were like, wow, did they make an M version of this? Anyway, I took it off after, a few months, but I thought that was, funny, and it certainly didn't age well.
Right on.
Yeah no M badges say, on non-M BMWs. We have trained Blue to attack the owners of all BMW owners that put M badges on 328i's.
Kyle, do you remember when I had it on my i3?
Oh, I remember. Yep, I do. It's why we're friends now. Now that it's removed.
Well, your dad liked me back then, so I couldn't have been that bad.
That's right. That's right. My dad still loves you.
All right. So that brings us to the end of our show. I'd like to thank you all for joining us. If you have any comments about any of the topics on today's show, you can comment on the Inside EVs podcast post, the YouTube comment section below, or on the Inside EVs forum podcast thread. And don't forget, you can find and follow our panelists on Twitter. Tom is at Tomalog. Martin is at EV News Daily. Kyle is at Out of Spec. And I'm Dominic_Y. Click subscribe and tap that bell icon for notifications. And we'll see you all next week. Ciao.